Hi, I'm Alex Dykes of thetruthaboutcars.com, and today we're taking a look at the 2013 Range Rover Evoque. Now, over the past few years, Range Rover has become more of a model line for Land Rover than a single model. So, of course, we have the full-size Range Rover, we have the Range Rover Sport, which is mid-sized SUV, and then we have this new Range Rover Evoque, which is basically an SUV for urbanites. So under the hood, we still have all-wheel drive, like you'd expect in a Range Rover product, but we also have a fuel-efficient 2-liter turbo engine. Let's hop in and take a look. Under the hood of the Evoque, we have a Ford-sourced 2-liter turbo engine. This particular engine produces 240 horsepower and 250 pound-feet of torque, has variable valve timing, as well as direct injection. Now, power is sent to all four wheels via a 6-speed automatic transmission and a Haldex all-wheel drive system. It's essentially the same setup that we have in the Volvo XC60, as well as the Land Rover LR2. Normally, when a luxury car manufacturer makes a smaller vehicle, the interior gets cheaper as well. Now, that holds true for just about everybody in the business. If you buy a C-Class, it's not quite as nice as an S-Class. If you buy a 3 Series, it's not quite as nice as a 7 Series. Here in the Range Rover Evoque, it's a little bit different and quite unusual, because this Range Rover Evoque has a cabin that in some ways is nicer than the next step up, which would be the Range Rover Sport. We're in the base model Evoque, and even this model has a stitched pleather dash. Now, this isn't leather, but it is a stitched dash. So all these pieces were cut individually, then stitched back together. It really dresses up this interior, more than you would think. You have to get in one to really see. All these trim panels are real aluminum, and they have a great feel to them. Everything in this car just is very well put together, and the components are very, very nice. Definitely belonging in a much more expensive vehicle, just in terms of feel. Now, we get a nice LCD screen in between the gauges as well in this particular car, and the only downside in this particular vehicle is this airbag cover, which, although not bad, does feel a little bit ordinary, and everything else in this cabin feels so great. Now, if you step up a notch in the Range Rover Evoque line to the Prestige model, then you get an even nicer interior with softer leather, leather dash bits, etc. One item that does seem to be skimped on, however, is the range of motion in this electric seat. And most SUVs in this particular segment have sort of an 8 or 10 way adjustable power seat. Either way, the seat bottom can either raise up and raise down as a single unit, can tilt forward, tilt backwards, etc. That doesn't happen in the Range Rover Evoque. Only the back of the seat lifts up and down, leaving the front of the seat fixed. So this means that I don't really have enough thigh support for me in this particular vehicle. Also, the range of motion in the lumbar support isn't as large as I thought it would be in a vehicle like this. Rear seat comfort in the Evoque is very good. These seat bottom cushions are higher off the floor than they are in many mass market crossovers, making it more comfortable for adults in the rear. These rear seats also fold flat with the cargo area, allowing you to dump larger cargo in the crossover. And our particular model is equipped with this enormous skylight. Now, this is a fixed piece of glass, but you can see it extends well beyond my head in the rear and all the way up to the front as well. Legroom in the Evoque, of course, is a little bit lower than you would find in something like a Volvo XC60, because, of course, this is a smaller vehicle. And this front seat is adjusted for me at 6 feet tall, and I do have a little bit of room left. But if I was a taller driver, or I liked a seating position that was more rearward, then you would have troubles fitting adults in the rear. The Range Rover Evoque scores 5 out of 10 points in our exclusive Trunk Comfort Index. It loses some points, of course, for the trunk being quite small. Now, you've noticed that on the outside of the Evoque, the rear is sloped quite a bit, and that means that the rear window is a little bit small. It does impact visibility a little bit, but it also impacts rear cargo room. Now, here in the rear, I have the largest roller bag you can carry on a domestic flight. As you can see, you couldn't carry too many of those in the Evoque. We do, however, gain a few points for having trunk hinges, and this is a power trunk, that don't impact on the cargo area in the back of the Evoque. It is now time to take a look at infotainment systems in the Range Rover Evoque. We'll start off here with the steering wheel. On the left, we have our phone buttons and our voice command button. We have our cruise control buttons over here on the right. We have our radio volume up, down, track forward, backward, and mode button over here. And we have our multi-information control button here. Now, that button controls this display in between the speedometer and the tachometer. Over here in the center console, you can see we have our climate control here. This is a dual zone climate control on the Range Rover Evoque. Now, none of these functions are repeated on the multi-information display up here. This is a completely separate system. And right above that, we have our power volume knob, track forward, backward, and our CD changer in dash right here as well. Higher up in the dash, we have an 8-inch LCD that is borrowed from the Jaguar XJ. And this is a bit of a good thing, because the rest of the Range Rover product line has a nav system that's getting pretty old, let's be honest. Now, this system has, as you can see, more modern mapping software. Also has a 3D mode, as you'd expect these days. Over here on the audio video screen, since we have the up-level system, we also have access to our satellite radio. We have access to our USB devices. If you click the little plus button again, you can also see that we have access to a DVD player, that's the in-dash DVD player, as well as an optional CD changer. We have access to Bluetooth streaming as well as an aux input in the center of the console. Back on the main menu, you can see that we have shortcuts to our audio settings, Take Me Home, our phone book, and extra features. Now, one of the nice features about the Range Rover Evoque is that it does have an optional all-around view camera. Now, this is very much like Infiniti's all-around view or BMW's multi-camera systems. There's a problem, though, because in those other systems, there's a shortcut button to see the camera. And here, you know, if you press this little P button, you get the parking sensor. So if we were in drive, we'll put it in drive so you can see. Little P sensor lights up, and now you can hear the parking sensors are on because we're in a parking lot. And if you put it in reverse, we do get a backup camera, and we have the narrow and wide views for the backup camera, but you'll notice that there's no way to use those all-around view cameras unless we go here to the home menu, hit the extra features button, and then hit cameras, and now you can see the different cameras that are in the car. There's one here, and one here, one up here, one back here, and another one right over here. Okay, so now you know where the cameras are. So these are the front two cameras on the front bumper. This is the camera under that side view mirror on the left. Now, we also have the special views, which is the junction view. That's just the two cameras up front. And we have the curb view, which is the two side cameras. So you can see it looks like we have a very narrow car because we're just seeing the cameras under each side view mirror. You also have the option of selecting any of these two images that you want and combining them into one view by hitting the enlarge button. So now you can see behind me and up front. And these cameras are active at any speed, so you can be tooling down the freeway at 70 miles an hour and view all of your little cameras, which is pretty good. The problem is it's not as useful as the all-around view camera from Infiniti or BMW because it doesn't stitch them together. Now, that being said, the camera quality is better than the Infiniti system or the BMW system, most notably. The Infiniti system is pretty good, but the BMW system, not only does it not show the front of the car at all, it really just shows the two sides and the rear, but the camera quality is strangely bad. The contrast is always off. I've never been able to get any of the BMW models with that system to have a really good image on them. And the image here is pretty good, but again, the usefulness is a little bit limited. Going back to the iPod for just a second here, you can see that the interface is much different than the rest of the Range Rover lineup or the Jaguar XF. Again, this is much more like the Jaguar XJ since it's using essentially the same software. This means that the responsiveness on the display is much, much, much better than the previous system. As you would expect, we can browse our playlists, our genres, our artists, etc. We have full access to the iPod or USB device in that respect, but there are still no voice commands in this system, although that's really not a big problem in the luxury segment because none of the luxury segment competitors really offer voice commands in this at this time. Back at the navigation system, address entry is fairly easy, but the system is not as responsive as I would like. So if we enter a house number here, you can see it lagged a little bit there, but it lags a bit more when you're entering a road here, as you can see the amount of time it takes to allow you to enter the next road in this system. Now, the one nice thing, however, is that you can enter an address at any time in this system, including while you're in motion. Now, obviously, that would be so that your passenger could enter an address for you, but if you did have a situation where it was an emergency and you needed to enter an address while you were driving, it is possible in this system, much like iDrive and MMI. And honestly, stabbing the screen like this, I don't find that any more distracting than twiddling a little iDrive knob, so I can't blame them for doing this. In fact, I prefer that they let me make my choice as to whether I want to take my eyes off the road to enter an address rather than restrict that for me, because again, your passenger can enter an address for you in this system. Our Evoque is also equipped with the optional 17-speaker 825-watt sound system. Now, aside from this sound system sounding like it belongs in a much more expensive car, we also get some interesting surround options, which I really haven't seen in a vehicle before. We have our choice of, you know, no surround, we have DTS Neo 6, the latest version of Dolby ProLogic 2X, and of course we get a custom Meridian sound package. Now, that sort of is what Meridian thinks a multi-channel surround sound system should be like. Sounds quite like DTS Neo 6, if I'm honest. The Range Rover Evoque starts just over $44,000, but be careful with those options because the price can escalate rather rapidly, topping out just over $60,000 for a fully loaded model. Now, our particular model here, as tested, rang in just under $50,000. As I said, the Evoque is sort of the city dweller's crossover vehicle, and that really makes sense when you drive it out on a winding California road like this, and that's because the Evoque has a fairly stiff suspension, fairly low profile tires for a crossover vehicle, and handles exceptionally well. Now, there's not a whole lot of steering feel as you'd expect in any modern vehicle, but there is a little bit, and it's probably a bit more than I had expected, to be honest. The steering is fairly firm. The only downer out here on this windy road is that this transmission is just not as psychic as the ZF 6-speed that's used in the other Range Rover vehicles, or even the ZF 8-speed that's used in the new BMW X1 and X3. That stiff suspension means that when you take your Evoque, even out on a well-maintained gravel road like we're on right now, the stiff suspension does make for a somewhat jarring ride. It's something that might bother me if I was really buying this and lived out in the country, because it is definitely more designed for on-pavement use. Although the Range Rover Evoque does handle very well, it is obvious out on these winding mountain roads that it is a front-wheel drive bias platform with a fairly heavy nose. Now, that's not to say there's any sort of torque steer going on here, because there really isn't any in the Evoque. It really locks up that Haldex unit frequently and for long periods of time, allowing the Evoque to be very neutral handling. That Haldex unit is also why the Range Rover Evoque gets such good highway fuel economy, because if you're at a steady speed on the highway, going 70 miles an hour or so, then the car is really sending almost all that power to the front wheels, and it's completely disconnecting that clutch pack. So there's really no power going to the rear wheels. That's what allows this Range Rover Evoque to get 28 miles per gallon on the highway, about 20 in the city or so, with a combined rating of about 21 to 22 in our mixed driving over 800 miles. Now, 240 horsepower motivating 4,000 pounds makes the Evoque sort of quick, but not exactly fast. It's not exactly slow either. We hit 0 to 60 in just about 7 seconds, and so that's a fairly respectable number for a crossover vehicle, but it's not as lightning quick as any of the Range Rovers with their supercharged V8. Perhaps trying to compensate for that, Range Rover equipped the Evoque with very aggressive throttle mapping, makes it a little bit difficult to take off from a stoplight slowly, and it probably makes you feel a little bit faster than you really are. Thankfully, the 2-liter turbo engine has a very broad torque curve, and while there is a little bit of turbo lag between idle and say about 1500 RPM or so, it's really not very noticeable, honestly. Comparisons with the Evoque are kind of difficult because other than the BMW X1, I'm really not sure what you'd cross-shop. Sure, you could cross-shop the LR2 or the Volvo XC60, on which both of these are ultimately kind of sort of based, or you could compare it to the BMW X1, X3, the Mercedes GLK, the Audi Q5, etc. But the Evoque is quite small compared to some of those, other than the BMW X1, that is. And some people try and equate it to the Mini Countryman, but I think that's really being unfair to Land Rover because, honestly, the Countryman just isn't as nice. If you've sat inside a Countryman and then you sat inside this, it's like going from a Nissan Versa to a Lexus. So who is the Range Rover Evoque for? Well, it's really for that city person that wants a Range Rover and they want that Range Rover style, but they don't need the full off-road capabilities or the size of the full-sized Range Rover models. Now, our particular model is just about as capable as any of the smaller Jeeps off-road, because it has a very similar all-wheel drive system. Haldex unit, sending power to the rear, can lock it, and it can send about 50% of the power to the rear, but it won't get you out of the same kind of sticky situations that you'd be able to get out of in a full-size Range Rover.